No dread? Isn't that a flavour of Mountain Dew? If you've been dipping your toes in the not just Alexa smart home space lately and have looked into making an advanced automations, you've probably heard the name Node-RED, which has probably left you wondering, what the heck is Node-RED? Welcome to Foxy's Lab. I'm Foxy, your friendly neighbourhood dog. And today we're talking about a tool that lets you build entire automations without writing any code, mostly. So go grab a coffee, I'll get one too, and then we'll get into it. Node-RED is a flow-based programming tool for wiring together devices, APIs, and online services. Think of it as like plumbing for your automations, or a visual brain for your smart home, or even an industrial system if you're feeling fancy. Instead of typing lines of code, you drag little coloured boxes onto a canvas, connect them up with wires, and then tell them what to do when the data flows through them. You can chain as many boxes together as you like and create some truly powerful automations without ever writing a single line of code. Here's a short history. The core idea started inside IBM back in 2013 as a little side project to make connecting IoT devices easier. Two developers named Nick O'Leary and Dave Conway Jones wanted a way to deal with data mapping between MQTT topics without writing complicated code all the time, and thought, what if we could just wire the logic together instead? That idea took off in a big way. In 2016, IBM donated Node-RED to what is now known as the OpenJS Foundation, and the rest is open source history. The magic of Node-RED comes from the flow. Data comes in through input nodes, like an MQTT message or a sense reading from something like Home Assistant. It passes through processing nodes, for things like routing logic and general data processing. And it ends up at output nodes. These could fire off a message, toggle a light, or trigger an API call. It's basically a choose your own adventure book made out of JSON. Let's get into the interface. When you open Node-RED, you'll see three main parts. On the left, the palette. These are where all your node types live. In the middle, there is the canvas, where you actually build your flows. And on the right, lives the inspector sidebar, where you can find things like your debug panel, configuration nodes, and the documentation. We'll get into those later. Generally speaking, each node does a single job. Connect a few nodes together, and suddenly you've built a full automation. Terminology is everywhere in tech, and Node-RED is no exception. So let's break the main terms down. A node is one of those colored boxes that you drag onto the canvas. Each one generally performs a single job, like listening for an MQTT message, making a HTTP request, or sending a notification. There is a function node that you can use if you want to write some code. This uses JavaScript. This node can be very useful for very complex behaviors that can't be covered with an existing node. I mentioned earlier that nodes only do one job each, but this one's an exception, as if you were so inclined, you could write an entire flow of operations in this single node. Handy if you just want to copy some existing functions from an already existing code base, but it's not really in the spirit of Node-RED. There are a ton of different nodes available to you with plenty of flexibility for you to pretty much build any automation you can think of. Make sure you subscribe and hit the bell, as I've got a video coming out soon where I break down each of the different nodes and explain what they're useful for. Of course, you're not limited to the nodes that Node-RED provides. There are thousands of community nodes available via plugins. Home automation ones like Zigbee to MQTT, Philips Hue with you're into that sort of thing, and of course Home Assistant. There are also cloud service ones for Google Sheets, Telegram, Discord, to name but three. Basically, if it has an API, someone's probably built a Node-RED node for it. Hell, I even made a Todoist one a few years back. Links in the description if you fancy a look. Nerd! So whilst the function node's there in a pinch if you need it, you'll probably find that you rarely, if ever, actually do. There's also a special type of node that doesn't live on the canvas called a configuration node.
You can't sit with us!
This is basically setup details for nodes that require the ability to connect to a service. For example, adding the broker details for an MQTT node. Nodes which require a configuration node appear on the canvas with a little red triangle above them. This indicates that they need to be connected to a configuration node before they can work. A flow is a connection of nodes connected together to perform a complete task. Think of it like a page in a notebook or a tab in a browser. Actually, that one's better, go with that one. Each tab holds one logical chunk of your setup, like lighting, notifications, or security. Personally, I have one tab per room in my house, as it makes organizing my smart home easier. A subflow is a reusable bundle of nodes. Basically a mini plugin or a component that you made yourself and can drop anywhere. I use subflows for common tasks like having Home Assistant send notifications or to handle error logging. The great thing is, if you change a subflow once, it updates everywhere it's used. It's a huge time saver and can solve a lot of headaches. A message is the packet of data that moves between nodes. It usually contains a message.payload, which is the actual data, along with metadata like message.topic, timestamps, and context variables. Understanding what's in that object is half the battle of Node-RED. The data a message contains can be just about anything that you could use as the contents of a regular variable in a programming language. You can even use semi-complex logic within a message by using an expression language called JSON ARTA. Context is how Node-RED remembers things. There's node context, which is stored just within a single node, flow context, which is shared with any node within the same tab, and then global context, which, as the name suggests, is shared across the whole workspace. The palette is the menu on the left with all your node types. You can install new ones from the Node-RED palette library, which is kind of like an app store, but for super nerds. Deploy is the big red button in the top right of the screen. Think of this button as a save and publish button. When you hit that button, it will make your changes live and you'll start seeing the nodes working.
It's working!
Until you hit deploy, your latest changes are unsaved and inactive. And finally, the debug panel. That's your best friend when things don't work. If you plug the output of any node into a debug node, you'll see exactly what's happening under the hood. It's where every Node-RED user spends most of their early days, and most of their late ones too. In fact, get used to the debug panel. You live there now. In my setup, Node-RED is the conductor of the whole orchestra. Not only is it the brains behind my entire smart home, it even does things like check my calendar and updates my Slack status if I'm not working, or if I'm in a meeting, or if I'm not working in a meeting. It monitors the traffic outside my house, so I know when it's the busiest. Link to the video above if you're interested in learning about that. It even monitors my entire network and lets me know if any of my servers have gone down. The only time that doesn't work is if the server that goes down is the one that Node-RED is on, but I can't really do much about that.
Duh, okay. I knew that.
Node-RED is crazy addictive. I started by wiring a button up to a lamp and making it turn the lights off when I left the house. Within the space of a single weekend, I'd made an automation for every smart item in my home, and I was browsing Amazon for even more cool smart home tech that I could automate. So yeah, brace yourself for that one.
Looks like we got ourselves an audit.
It's simple enough for non-coders to pick up within minutes, but deep enough that developers can lose entire weekends refining flows. Or many, many weekends in my case.
Yep, I'm a goner.
That mixture of accessibility and power makes it dangerously addictive, because once you realize how fast you can build things, you won't want to stop. As with any simple but powerful tool, here are the gotchas. Not deploying often can be a big problem. As I mentioned earlier, the deploy button is not just publish, it's also save. And Node-RED doesn't come with an autosave option. So if you accidentally refresh your browser, or if it crashes and you've not hit deploy in a while, all that work's gone.
No.
By default, the debug node only shows message.payload, which is great for most issues, right up until it isn't. Sometimes the thing you're actually trying to debug is hidden somewhere else in the message object, outside of the payload. So switch it to complete message if you want to see what's really going on under the hood. Otherwise, you're only seeing part of the output and you can easily miss something. You don't need to do that all of the time, but it's handy to debug things like connection errors and other configuration issues. As your flows get more complex, JSON ARTA is something you may have to use often. Personally, I would have preferred the option of either JSON ARTA or just regular JavaScript in my expressions, as I'm not a big fan of the former. While JSON ARTA is a bit friendlier for non-developers to use, there's still a learning curve and plenty of ways for it to trip you up. So before you dive in, it's probably worth watching a few YouTube videos or reading some articles about JSON ARTA to give yourself a fighting chance. If that's something you'd be interested in me covering, let me know in the comments and I'll see about making a video. The community panel is a treasure trove, but fair warning, here be dragons. For every polished, beautifully maintained node, there is another one written in 2017 by someone who's since vanished into the mist. Before installing anything, check when it was last updated and make sure it's got a good reputation. Remember that ultimately, it's just a list of Node-RED compatible NPM packages and is wide open for anyone to add to. It is not curated in any way. Recent NPM controversies have shown that you can't always trust packages on NPM, and some of them are even vectors for an attack. If it predates the pandemic or has hardly any downloads, give it a wide berth unless you're comfortable giving the package a thorough check through yourself. Context is not persistent by default. If you start using context and you expect it to survive a restart of Node-RED,
I've got some bad news.
You can enable file-based context by editing a settings file. This will save context to the file system instead of memory, and it will survive for as long as you maintain that file. I'll talk more about the settings file later on. Rule 1, label everything. Future you won't remember what that random node does. Some nodes will automatically choose a sensible name, but many do not. And trust me, if you don't have sensible node names at the start, you'll be kicking yourself later when things get complex. Rule 2, use subflows when they make sense. Subflows are so insanely powerful that once you start using them, you'll realize you've probably been repeating yourself a lot in many of your flows.
I shall say this only once.
Save yourself the hassle and get used to using them right away. Making an error handling subflow is a good start. I'll put a link to mine in the description so you can check it out. Rule 3, leave comments and use groups. You can use a comment node to make notes, and you can group flows together within the same flow tab, which you can then name. This helps keep things organized and will save you a lot of trouble. Rule 4, keep the logic clean and simple. Whilst Node-RED doesn't need you to write code, following the best practices of writing code is still a good idea. The most important one to follow is KISS, K-I-S-S. Keep it stupidly simple. Adding really complex flows may make you feel like a badass, but there's a good chance you're just over-engineering. Rule 5, back up your flows. You will break it at some point, and trust me when I tell you that keeping backups can be a lifesaver. Personally, I've enabled projects in my Node-RED instance, so all of my flows are backed up to Git every time I hit deploy. You can add this via the settings.js file. Rule 6, secure your instances. Don't expose your editor to the internet. If you must, put it behind a reverse proxy with auth and TLS. Also, modify your settings.js file to enable authentication in the editor window. Without it, anyone with access to your network also has access to all of your Node-RED flows and any credentials you have set in the configuration. As there are a few times I've mentioned editing the settings.js file in this video now, I'll put a link in the description to the official documentation for all of the things you need to do to secure your instance, enable persistent content, and to enable Git backups. One quick tip before we wrap up. Everything in Node-RED is represented as JSON, which means it can be exported and imported like any other JSON file. You can use this functionality to back up your flows or move them to another instance or share them with your friends or YouTube fans. There are a ton of community-made flows out there on the internet. I've shared a couple of mine as GitHub gists in the description of this video. Check them out. Small word of caution here though. Importing nodes onto your server is importing other people's code and running it on your machine. This means you need to be sure that you trust the person who provided you with the flows and you've got the ability to assess the risk yourself. Also, some flows are likely shared with specific configuration nodes in mind, so make sure you have those nodes installed and configured if you come across any issues. So that's Node-RED, a powerful and free bit of software that you can wire your world together with. It's simple, flexible, and weirdly satisfying once you start thinking in nodes instead of lines of code. If this video helped or at least entertained you, give that subscribe button a good old click. Give me a little like too while you're down there. If you enjoyed this video, then there's plenty more like it on the way. Hit the bell if you want to be notified when the next one comes out. Hell, why not make your first Node-RED flow an automation that will notify you whenever I post a new video? It could do that, you know. Ta-ra.